there is a flurry of new discussions going on in the Polkadot ecosystem, especially since Gavin Wood gave his presentation on the next iteration of Polkadot, all the improvements that are coming. And one thing that I'm especially interested in at the moment is that there are a lot of discussions around tokenomics. So Polkadot has very solid tokenomics, but there is discussion going on, and I've been observing that there are different discussions going on. So it is becoming obvious that people can form an opinion and participate in a discussion and decide on the future of Polkadot. So if you are economically inclined, this right now is a very interesting stage for Polkadot. And welcome to Addison Bob. Today we are going to talk about the existing tokenomics of Polkadot and then three current trends that are happening. Number one is fixed treasury inflow. So this is part of inflation, core time sales, and burn mechanics that are being discussed. So a deflationary mechanism. If you're only interested in one of the topics, at the bottom of the video, you can jump to the right time markers or in the description and look at that part of the video. Let's jump in. Before we go into the trends of the discussions, what I want to go into is how Polkadot tokenomics work right now. And this is its own discussion, and I think I haven't seen any source on this, so this is a little bit of a summary for you. How do Polkadot tokenomics work? I want to start with stakeholders. So any tokenomic system is basically consisting of different stakeholders that are working together, coordinating together to create some value. And the value of the Polkadot network is secure block space to power unstoppable, secure, trustless applications. So let's look at the stakeholders. We have holders. These are people just holding tokens, maybe using them in DeFi, maybe not doing anything at all, maybe just voting in governance. Then we have validators. This is basically the nodes that are creating blocks. They get rewarded with block production rewards and with rewards for inclusion of transactions into the system. Then we have delegators and stakers. So these are the people that are staking. They are putting on risk, nominating, delegating to nodes, to validators, and putting on the risk of selecting the wrong node, getting slashed if they select misbehaving nodes. But if they select nodes that are behaving correctly, they get a reward from the system in the form of inflation. One interesting thing is that a lot of stakers are also governors or participating in governance. Not everyone, but a lot of people, because you can stake and participate in governance at the same time. And so you would be interested in combining those effects. Then there is the treasury. The treasury is controlled by governance and is spending dot on different initiatives that are being proposed to the on-chain governance. And then there are parachains. So at the moment, parachains are locking up DOT tokens in exchange for getting a secured allocation of block space, and basically they guarantee that they can keep producing blocks in the ecosystem for 6 to 24 months. Okay, we have the stakeholders laid out, and now let's look at all the dynamics that are happening between those stakeholders. So this is basically value dynamics. So where is value flowing to? Where is it flowing away from? And where is it flowing to? The first thing that we can state is that value accrues to validators, delegators, and the treasury. What it means is that validators and delegators get rewarded for securing the system. This happens in the form of them getting tokens. And this is basically inflation. And I want to really point this out because this is a very common misconception that I see. Inflation by itself is not bad. It is a mechanism of the system. And what it does is it redistributes purchasing power. So the number of tokens gets more. Let's say you have 10% inflation. So at the beginning of the year, you have 100 million tokens. And at the end of the year, you have 110 million tokens. But If the value of the system stays the same, let's say the market cap, then the only thing that happens is that some people at the beginning of the year maybe had 50% of the tokens together, and at the end of the year they gained 10% in relative power, so they hold 55% of the purchasing power. So it is a redistribution of purchasing power. The system rewards some people, advantages some people at the disadvantage of other people. So who does the Polkadot system want to reward or distribute purchasing power to? It's the people that are securing the system, because securing the system with the token is the base function of the system. It wants to create secure block space, and it can only do that by someone providing the security, by taking on the risk of proof of stake. So inflation by itself is not bad. It is just a mechanism that redistributes purchasing power. And validators, delegators are the ones that are profiting from that. Okay, now the treasury is also getting a value accrual, and that is basically, so in the case of Polkadot, it works like this, that there is the assumption of the treasury performs or invests money in a way that it is net positive for the whole system. It's a common good and it's net positive. And so the system is designed that the treasury gets some DOT tokens to spend. So we have a few winners, and on the other hand, that means we have a few losers in terms of losing purchasing power. And these are parachains and holders. So parachains lock up DOT tokens, and they have opportunity costs. They cannot do anything with the DOT tokens. And so they are losing in relative power to the people that are staking. So, and then there are holders. They are also not staking. They are not securing the system. And so purchasing power is also removed from them towards the people that are securing the system. But let's say parachains and holders use the DOT in another way. They are holding it, but they might be using it for different purposes where they think it's more valuable to them. Okay, now we can take all of those dynamics together. And what we can see is that there is inflation, and the inflation is set to be 10% per year. And one observation we can make is that about 50% of token holders are staking. It goes up, it goes down, let's say roughly 50%. And that means that those 50% roughly are the recipients of the inflation. So they, I think at the moment they receive like 16 or 20%. And then we have deflationary mechanisms. So there is one deflationary mechanism where value that is in the treasury is getting burned. And this is basically unspent tokens that are not spent on proposals during a period. And this is sort of a percentage or so of all the tokens that are in the treasury get burned every spending cycle. And I think a spending cycle might be a week or 4 weeks or so. But what we have to note is that the deflation right now in the Polkadot system is negligible. So it's not a lot of tokens that get burned. It's a rather slow burn. Okay, so we got the basics settled. Now let's look into the current discussions of how changes to tokenomics are being discussed. So discussion number one is for a fixed treasury inflow. So the discussion is as follows. In the case of Polkadot, treasury inflow is mostly dependent on staking rate. So the amount of DOT tokens that are being staked in relation to the total amount of DOT tokens. We just discussed that about 50% of all DOT tokens are being staked. And the system defines an ideal staking rate. So if the ideal staking rate is not achieved, then some of the tokens go to the stakers and some of the tokens go to the treasury. So that means if too little tokens or too much tokens are being staked, the ideal staking rate is also like roughly half. If the ideal staking rate is achieved in the system by all stakers together on aggregate, then treasury inflow goes down to zero. That's the way the system right now is designed. But there is a problem because spending has increased, and so we can look at this at the side here. So there is a certain inflow, but this inflow is sort of, it seems to have dropped recently. And the outflow of the treasury is increasing. So you can follow this black line here. That is basically the net, the sum of those dynamics of the inflow and the outflow. And you can see that we're seeing periods now of net outflow of the treasury. So this is why this discussion is being started right now. And on net, there is a treasury outflow. So there is a proposal now on a Polkadot forum that instead of being just dependent on the ideal staking rate, there should be a fixed portion of the inflation that automatically goes to the treasury. The proposal right now is that it's 2% of the inflation. I also made a contribution there saying it should be lower, it should be like 0.5%. But if you're interested in the discussion, you can go into the Polkadot forum and participate in the discussion. Okay, second discussion that is happening right now is around Coretime sales. So as of today, parachains get Coretime. And what do we mean by Coretime? Coretime is a rather new word that is being discussed, but it basically means to get an allocation of block space. So Polkadot is a multi-core computer. It runs many different cores, and every parachain runs on a core, like you have a computer that is a multi-core computer and has many different cores on the CPU. So every parachain runs on a core, and if the parachain wants to run, it needs to purchase or lease core time. Right now, the core time is leased by locking DOT tokens. They're just locked, they're not being lost. This mechanism will now change for multiple reasons, mostly to make the system like quicker to react and only sell block space on a four-weekly basis, so roughly once a month there will be a sale of bulk block space, and also instantaneous block space sales. So the selling mechanism of block space will become more flexible and resolve more quickly to allow quicker adaptation of the system and to allow developers and tinkerers to quickly onboard into the system and just try it out. But the main difference will be that core time will be sold in the future and not leased. And the current proposal, this is RFC1 by Gavin Wood. So Polkadot is now transitioning into an RFC system where changes to the system are being proposed in RFCs. The proposal by Gavin Wood states that the value will accrue to core time providers, and the biggest core, so my understanding is the biggest core time provider is the treasury. So value will accrue to the treasury through core time sales. And that means that in the future, there is a new source of income for the treasury. So you see that this is already conflicting a little bit with the previous proposal that we just saw, but it's hard to estimate because all of these things are in movement. And so we just need to keep up to date with the discussion and keep synchronizing between those discussions. Third discussion, DOT burn. So I guess this is greatly inspired by how Ethereum introduced a burn mechanism that is so strong that you can see right here, up until to the introduction of the merge, where the burn was introduced, you can see how Ethereum essentially changed from being inflationary to slowly deflationary. The question I want to put in, I see this being asked by many people. So there are many people on Twitter, you see them appearing saying, why is there so much inflation on Polkadot? It's so high. And a similar breed of people are saying, why is there no burn, right? So it's a meme in a way, because you don't have to understand economics too much to find token burn sexy. It's like a concept, the amount of tokens is getting less. If I just hold the tokens, I'm gaining value. Right, so this is the basic thinking, and so this is why many people subscribe to the idea. So let's take it apart a little bit, because it's an ongoing discussion and it had received more fire recently because I also was misreading some ideas and communication. I was thinking there is a burn planned, but it's sort of discussed at the moment. So the basic idea is that money coming in from core time sales, value coming in from core time sales, coming into the treasury could get burned, and the treasury by itself could also more often decide to do a burn. Okay, so now we see some conflicting statements, because on the one side, the argument is inflation should come to the treasury. And now from the other side, there is the argument of deflation should be applied to the treasury, right? So I think the most appropriate point of discussion is, if there is a core time sale, should all of the value go to the treasury, or should there be a burn applied? This is an interesting discussion to have. I'm definitely going to participate. But let's think about this a little bit, because if we say that inflation is a redistribution of purchasing power, because inflation goes to some participants and not to others, then the question is deflation also a redistribution of purchasing power? And if so, from whom to whom? And in a sense, if you have deflation, it basically means that tokens during some process get removed from the system instead of having a recipient. So it doesn't make too much sense. Of course, the treasury could say they are going to apply a burn. It can make sense in certain contexts. But where it makes more sense is if, for example, you have a core time sale, and so this process especially leads to a deflation, because someone is paying for core time, but there is no recipient of the token. And instead, the system decides that the accrual of value that is being generated from paying for the block space is to be distributed equally to everyone in the system. Under this condition, a burn can make sense. So no matter if you're for or against the burn, it's a good meme. That's why it is being discussed. And so we should look at it economically, if it does make sense. And if it does make sense, then we can discuss it. But this is a question that I think we will soon start leading on a broader scale. And it's maybe just a question of how much of core time sales should get burned. Is it 0%? Is it 50%? Is it 100%? Or is it anything in between? Or is it determined by any other mechanism or percentage or algorithm or function? Okay, that's it for today. If you find this content interesting, feel free to follow me on Twitter at EdisonBob. You can also learn more about Polkadot 2.0. I recently posted this on my channel here. And you can also feel free to participate in the Polkadot forum. It has very interesting discussions. And so thank you for listening today. All the best to you. Goodbye.